Well, the Prime Minister touches down in New York in the coming hour, and running the country in his absence is Acting Prime Minister Barnaby Joyce, who joins us now from New South Wales. Barnaby, good morning to you. Thanks for your time this morning. Appreciate it. Look, there's plenty of heat out there in the community, isn't there, Barnaby? Neo-Nazis on the street of Melbourne. I mean, what is going on?
Well, the heat's out there in the street. I tell you, it's not on this ridge. It's just dropping just dropping through the floor, the temperature here. But look, I don't know. It's up to them to work out. It's their honey smacks, and they've got to work out what went on yesterday. Whether it was anti-vaxxers or a split in the CFMEU, nobody wants violence, and it just intimidates people. It makes people scared. It makes people angry when they see it on television. Now, if the CFMEU says it's got nothing to do with them, well, then it sounds like an issue for the police. I'm sure they'll be going through the cameras and trying to work out what was going on. But I don't know, it just looked like a complete melee. And they I don't know, some of them seem to know each other, so they have to work it out.
It was
Victorian
trouble,
problem.
It?
Go work it out, Victoria.
It was awful. Victoria will remain pretty ordinary, actually.
Yeah,
Victoria will remain, as you know, mostly locked down until 80% vaccinations. The national agreement, as you know, is 70%. Now Queensland says 90%, although we may have heard this morning that may not be completely right. It may be somewhere between 80% and 90%, but it's not 80%. We know WA, they'll come out of lockdown in Easter 2032. Why hasn't the national agreement worked, do you believe?
Well, I think that people either believe the statistics that the Doherty Institute brought forward or they don't. What we've got to do is make sure that we get to the other end of this, Carl. All these problems are going to go once we get to a position where enough people are vaccinated, where we say to everybody else, well, if you don't want to get vaccinated and the vaccines are there at your chemist shop or your GP, and I suppose that'll be around about the end of October, well, it's over to you. Australia's got to move on, and we've got to take the heat out of this situation, and we've got to get the economy working again. Now, if people have different ideas about an independent party, which is Doherty Institute, well, that's a question between them and the Doherty Institute. Now, we're going to follow it because we find that out of a whole myriad of opinions, and by God, aren't there a lot of them out there at the moment, these are probably the most competent ones to listen to.
The thing is, you know, I think Australians, by and large, have done the right thing. They've gone above and beyond. I was at a vaccination hub last night with my daughter, who's 16, at like 8 o'clock at night getting her double dose. And when you hear our leaders go, you know what, yeah, the national plan was 80%, but we're not sticking to it, it instills in you an element of anger because you're playing ball. I mean, what do you say to these leaders? What are you going to say to the state leaders in order to bring them into line?
Well, it's like herding cats. For a while there, we went from a federation back to, I don't know, to little colonies again, where I was waiting for Queensland to get their own Air Force and West Australia to get their own, I don't know, Navy. But we are a nation and we should have worked to a national plan, but the premiers make the decisions about where this goes, not us. We give them advice, we give them the vaccines, and they make the health plans. If they want to move away and go on to a sort of a different track, well, that's up to them, but the competent advice is laid out in the Doherty report.
You're used to herding.
And who else are you going to follow?
You're used to herding cats, though, Barnaby.
Well, I'm going to be herding cattle on the weekend. What? Herding? Mustering. Herding is an American term. We muster.
Now, let's move on. A couple of others to get through. Have you ever received an anonymous donation in a blind trust?
No, I don't think so. No, I don't. No. I can assure you, no, I haven't.
Are you sure?
Well, unless you can tell me now that I have, I've never received an anonymous donation from a blind trust, no.
Okay. Do you think that it's acceptable?
Well, is it against the law? It's obviously not acceptable if you're a minister, and therefore Christian Porter's done what he thought he had to do, and he's stepped down. He's now in the backbench, and as I've said, you're out there in the corridor of the afflicted, and I hope at some stage he gets the opportunity to come back. I think he's very competent. I think he's very intelligent. He's going to spend his time in Coventry, and that's what happens. But he didn't break the law. I think it's really important. There's no law he's broken. There's a code, a ministerial code.
Yeah.
That is not the law. That is the code of the Prime Minister.
I reckon if you walked into any pub just down the road from where you are right now, and you said, look, I'm getting cash through a blind trust. I don't know where it's come from. It's not going to pass the pub test in any part of this country.
Mate, if I walked into a pub just down the road from here right now, what I'd get is the address of the AA conference, mate, because it's about 7 a.m. But anyhow, but in regards to pub tests, yeah, I know that. But there's a lot of differences between the perception on the street and many issues. But this is the ministerial code of conduct is called precisely that. It's for ministers. It's administered by the Prime Minister. The Minister, Christian Porter, has of his own volition stepped down. He is now on the backbench. Now it's between him and the people, the electorate of Pearce, and they'll make a decision. I hope they make the right one and re-elect him.
It calls into questions that, I mean, you receive X amount, you receive $1 million in a trust, you know, pay tax on it, you don't know where it's exactly come from. I mean, there are just so many, there is a myriad of questions that I don't get. Anyway, we'll move on. The PM will meet with the US President in Washington this week. You know they'll be pushing for emission reduction targets. Dave Sharma this morning in The Australian wants 40% by 2035. At the same time, Matt Canavan wants a new coal-fired power station in Queensland. Who wins that battle internally?
Well, that's the great thing about democracy, isn't it? They are allowed to express their views and stand behind it. Both of them are incredibly smart,
cogent people. But you have firm views on this, though.
You know, well, I'll tell you what I look at is... Dave Sharma is a great bloke, and he's talking to his constituents in the seat of Wentworth, okay, in the seat of Wentworth in you know, Bellevue Hill, Vaucluse, and that area. And they're great people entitled to their views. Now, I've got to represent the people out there and their jobs.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's the Musselbrooks, that's the Singletons, that's the Tamindas in Tamworth, that's the farming sector. We've got to make sure that we keep them in a job because they want me to do the job for them. And looking after them. We see what's happening in the UK now with the crisis they're having in gas supplies as they're going into their winter. We want to make sure we don't do that to our people. It's got to be a cogent process. Otherwise, the people who get hurt are the people watching your program.
It's going to be an interesting dilemma for that one to work through. Barnaby, good to talk to you. Thanks for your time today. Appreciate it. Have a great day. Herding those cattle and...
You're welcome,
cats.
Carl. See you, mate.
He's mustering, my friend.
Early out now.